when you're with Martin Armstrong, armstrongeconomics.com, you're going to get insights that you never thought were possible. Martin, welcome back to the show.
Oh, well, thank you for inviting me.
As always. So first, start with North Korea. Is it too good to be true, or is there some backstory going on? How does that correspond with the war cycle?
Basically, his posture has been typical of a tyrant. When you begin to run into a situation where the economy is very bad, the people are kind of starving, etc., if you are trying to prevent an uprising, you have to find an external enemy. And that's basically what he's been doing. Posturing a lot, saber rattling, etc. Now, all of a sudden, this change is because either his choice is he goes to war, in which case he knows he's going to lose, or he's got to do something to prevent the people from uprising. And so the other solution is, okay, fine, maybe, we try talking. Because he's clearly listening to somebody, because this is a guy who is basically a kid who's grown up and never really had any real world experience, period. Mm-hmm. So it's just very, very different from a standpoint. I mean, typically that's where war comes into play. And I still think it's more of a concern on the European side than I do on the Korean side. I know people envision, nuclear weapons going off and all over the place. But, that presents a fairly significant problem. And I think China would actually, behind the curtain, would step in. Because is the U.S. going to send off nukes? They're going to, land in North Korea? The pollution also tends to affect South Korea and China. That would be like Russia declaring war on Canada and sending a nuke to Toronto. Are we going to stand for that? So, I don't see that as the huge political risk that a lot of people have been touting. I think the more deeper concern still lies in Europe. Because Russia still has a problem, and that is that I've explained this before. I've been to both places, even when they were communists, all right? And we have a label of communism, but it didn't basically play out the same way. In China, they had what is called the tall poppy syndrome. So if you stick your head up and you start making a lot of noise, it's going to be cut off. Long as you can sit around the table, complain to your wife, you hate the government, whatever, they don't care, all right? In Russia, that was not the case. Even Lenin, and you can Google this, most people don't realize, but Lenin, he pleaded not to succeed him with Stalin. And he said the guy is basically a loose cannon. And once Stalin got in, that was it. The number of people that he killed is still never really definitive. It's in Russia itself, it could be 20 million. I know in Ukraine, he didn't execute people. He starved them to death. He took all their food. And over 8 million Ukrainians died. That's why Ukraine basically doesn't like the Russians, period.
Yeah.
And so what you have in Russia is that when communism fell, it just really went from communism to an oligarchy. Basically, the politicians, those that had the connections, they just took over the state things. You can't even open a restaurant in Moscow in competition with an oligarch. You'll be lucky if you live by the end of the day. So
yeah,
it's a different thing. This is why China boomed, because they left humanity intact. Mm-hmm. So once communism failed, boom. I mean, they just were running, and, you know, from day one. And so, you know, they're going to surpass Europe as a whole, as far as an economy is concerned, this year. And I mean, they will eventually pass the United States, and we will be looking at, the West is declining, and they will become the new financial power after 2032. Russia doesn't stand, you know, a prayer in hell of getting there. All right. It's way down the list. It's nowhere even close to even the top 20. So it is basically a country armed to the teeth, but without really an economy. Mm-hmm. So you have much greater problems there in Russia, that eventually the people rise up. So we have the same situation. You either acquiesce to the domestic upheaval and you reform, or you find an external enemy. Simple as that. It's always throughout history, you know, and it's not something that's my personal opinion. You know, I think this is going to happen or whatever. I mean, everybody's got an opinion. That's very nice. But I'm just looking at, historically, you end up with a black and white situation. Mm. And so it's either a revolution and the government is overthrown, or the government first finds an external enemy to try and, you know, distract the people and say, see, it's not me, it's them. Mm-hmm. So this is basically what goes on. And, you know, we see this philosophy even in our political elections. I mean, the Democrats basically are always really after the rich and corporations, and this is what they stand up and say, all right? They're always a philosophy of divide and conquer. Behind the curtain, they're always like, you know, hey, give me some money and don't worry, I'll fix it for you. I mean, so it was like Hillary, you know, standing up and saying that you have to have two things that you say, one publicly, one privately.
Yeah. Right.
But, you know, people have asked me many times, are you Republican or Democrat? And I'm telling you, look, I've worked with governments around the world and in Washington. Yes, the Democrats will always talk up about the social things and all this. I say, when it comes to the money, they're both the same.
Yeah.
Just show me the money. That's mm-hmm. it. They push the buttons with everybody on the social issues. When it comes to economics, it's really the same thing. So, this is way politics and governments work throughout history. Mm-hmm. So the more concern I have remains on the other side. And one of the sparks really in the tinderbox for war is really in the Middle East that people are not paying attention to.
Mm-hmm.
And that is this rising conflict between Saudi Arabia and Iran. And it's a religious conflict, which is kind of like the Catholics and the Protestants in England and Ireland, etc., in Northern Europe. I mean, here you have the Shiites that basically believe that the government should be run by the religion.
Mm-hmm.
So you have the Ayatollah is basically the head of state. Saudi Arabia has a king, all right? So they're Sunni. They don't believe in that. They believe in separation of church and state. So, you know, this is really why the two of them are always at each other's throats. And as the economy goes down, both of them need to escalate the war. Mm-hmm.
Right.
So you will see much more there. And then that's going to lead largely to U.S. versus Russia confrontation, and both will pick sides.
Mm-hmm.
That's much more, you know, dangerous, and I would pay attention to what's going on. You see Saudi Arabia realizing when oil went down, you know, they're having the issue bonds. for the first time. I mean, their budgets are go into deficit, largely because this is they were counting on 200-hour oil forever and ever, and now suddenly they realize that's not going to happen. But their budgets expanded dramatically, anticipating that kind of revenue for forever and ever. So the fact that oil went down instead of up really kind of has changed the politics over there. Plus the fracking and stuff like that in the U.S. The U.S. is now poised to be the biggest producer of oil in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, people don't pay attention to that.
Oh yeah.
And you have a lot of these people keep talking about, the dollar is going to crash. It's Saudi Arabia. You know, the petrodollar. These things are just old theories from the 70s. It's absolutely a joke. I mean, if you look at oil from a perspective of the world economy, it's about 7%. And they call this the petrodollar, mm-hmm. Iran's going to use, euros and this is going to kill the dollar. Yeah, good luck.
Right. So the stock market's going to keep going along its merry way here. What about what happened last month with that, 1,000-point, 1,100-point loss in a couple of days? Are we going to see more volatility?
1,000 points in 1987 was a big deal.
Right.
Yeah. Today it's not percentage wise. We have, we came out and said actually that weekend said this is it. We got a high and we're going to go in for a little correction at this stage. The first half of this year, we've been warning, looks more like consolidation and choppiness.
Mm-hmm.
All right. This is the market's gone up for 8 years and you have to pause it sometime.
Right.
And you have all these people coming out and saying the market's going to crash by 40%, 50%, 60%. This is just opinion and it's also isn't really steeped in any kind of serious analysis whatsoever. They're just looking at the chart and say, oh, that's it. Okay, fine. Compare what everything else is going on to those former highs. 87 was currency, all right? 29 was much, much different. That was also a capital contraction into the U.S. because of problems in Europe. But, I mean, percentage-wise, if the Dow were to go up the same way as it did for 1929, we should be looking at around 50,000 on the Dow. We're nowhere close to it. So the first half this year is choppy consolidation. And I don't really see anything change until after July. But you have to understand that economically, the biggest crisis is in Europe.
Mm-hmm.
The problem there is that despite what Draghi stood up and said that, oh, he's going to back off of quantitative easing, I can tell you I speak with very reliable sources right behind the curtain, and everyone is very concerned because Draghi is not doing so, and he realizes that he's trapped.
Mm-hmm.
German 10-year bonds are more than 200 basis points below U.S. 10-year bonds. I mean, it's insane. All that is simply just a bet against the euro, and people over here don't understand that. I mean, you have Europeans that buy the bonds, not because of they're making some fantastic interest rate. It's a hedge because they figure the euro is going to collapse, and at least they get Deutschmarks. That's the trade. And it's been going on over there for over 3 years. So Draghi basically has created a huge, huge crisis. We have a pension crisis, which is really just global. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, what's going to be with places like Illinois? Well, every state in the country, with a couple of minor exceptions like Nebraska, is way behind on their pensions and they can never catch up unless the market goes doubles next year, right? That's the only way they're going to get up.
We have probably more than 25 of the biggest pension funds in the world come to our economic conferences. All right. You sit there, all right. They need basically 8%, all right, to cover future liabilities. How can they buy a 10-year bond even at 3%?
Yeah.
They can't. It's locking in more than a, you know, more than a 50% loss. All right. What has changed here is that the entire portfolio mix that was standard, 60% equities, 40% bonds, is a loser. They're bleeding out of every orifice, you know, and so, can the stock market go up? Yes, the stock market can double even from here. The problem is basically the, you know, the bond side, and the, you know, the ECB owns more than 40% of all government debt.
Wow.
If it stops, will any institution buy this stuff at negative to less than 1%? No, they can't. They can't possibly cover their future liabilities. This is what he's scared about.
For good reason.
All right. They've put in all kinds of laws. You can't short government bonds in Europe. It's against the law. He's bought more than 40% of all the debt. He has come out and said, okay, fine, he will continue to, when the debt expires, he'll reinvest. The Fed has said, no, we're going to let everything expire. All right. You have all these people bashing the Fed all the time. They have no clue how bad things are outside the country. The Fed looks like, you know, a diamond in the rough.
Like they know what they're doing, huh?
Yes. I mean, look, I was writing some of the questions for the House Banking Committee to ask the Fed when they testified. They asked me, would I do that? And I said, yeah, okay, fine. I know what's going on. The Fed wanted to raise interest rates back in 2014. Everybody's lobbying against them. The IMF, the ECB say, oh, if you do that, you know, you're going to kill us. You know, you can't do that. Emerging markets will collapse, etc. The biggest problem in Washington that, I mean, I've been in meetings in, is that they know they have to end the dollar as a reserve currency. They don't know how to do it. You can't pass a law because there's just no competition.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, more than 40% of the paper currency circulates outside the country. You can't use euros or something else. Why? Because everybody else routinely cancels their currency. Just like India made news. Okay, fine. But in Europe, I mean, you can Google it. You can find out. You know, old British pound notes, they're canceled. You have to exchange them in. The U.S. is the only paper currency that if you have a bill from 1840 or 1861 when they first started, it's still legal tender.
Correct.
U.S. currency has never been canceled.
All right.
Larry Summers was arguing for that. We should cancel $150 bills. It's just a joke. Because the money doesn't even circulate in the United States. The majority of $150 bills are outside the country. And it is the alternative to everybody else's currency. I mean, you find dollars circulating in China and Russia. I mean, I've gone on vacation to Greece and I said, gee, if you pay in cash, 10% off.
Yeah.
And they want the dollars. They don't want the euros.
Yeah. So are we still looking at gold resuming its upward rise later in the year?
Yeah, gold is in a position where a strong dollar is going to hurt it at first. But what you need is there are a lot of people that are into the gold or financial markets, whatever, that understand what I'm talking about, that there are economic problems. All right. That is really maybe at best 7% of the population. Mm-hmm. All right. So what's going to make gold go up? What's going to make it go up is when you pass that 7% level and you're now up at 25-30%. When people begin to question the validity of government and what's going on, then you'll see it go. I mean, all this nonsense about, oh, hyperinflation, increase in the money supply. How many years have we listened to that? I mean, it's just a joke. It doesn't matter. You can increase the quantity of money, no problem. If people don't spend it, you're not going to get the inflation. That's what 10 years of quantitative easing in Europe has failed to produce inflation. Why? Because they're hoarding it. Then you took interest rates negative. I mean, you can Google it. What was the number one selling thing? Safes.
Yeah.
People took money out of the banks and just started putting cash. That was it.
Very true. So
they're not ready to flip over, per se, and, you know, the majority of people into gold or something like that yet. It will come, but it's a question of confidence. Mm-hmm. It's when the majority of people begin to question government. That's when the stuff begins to move. I was around there and back going into 1980. I mean, they were hoarding toilet paper. I mean, everything was going
like,
up.
Like Venezuela. But until...
Yeah, I mean, exactly. Yeah. I mean, when you lose confidence in the currency, that's when everything is going to rise. We're at a beginning stage. So the market has come up like 8%. But, I mean, I've done interviews. People have called me for an interview. And I said, why are you calling me? Why do you want an interview for? I said, well, we just need somebody who's bullish on the stock market. Everybody we have is bearish.
You balance things out, huh? That's your purpose, a counterbalance.
Yeah, you've had basically an 8-year rally with, you know, all the talking heads constantly saying every new high is it. You know, oh, it's going to crash. Oh, it's going to fall. Oh, it's this. It's that. It's overpriced. And they have no clue what they're talking about. We're talking about basically from an international capital flow perspective, period. That's it. Mm-hmm. And it's the same thing with in 1987. I posted the letters. I mean, I was called in 1985 when they were going to create the G5. I was one of 35 people who was asked. And first I thought, wow, you know, I guess maybe I made it, you know, because I was one of the top foreign exchange advisors in the world. So you get there and it was like, geez, you know, Mr. Armstrong, how do we save the world? Oh, very sorry, your 15 minutes is up next. You know, and then they stand up and they say what they wanted to do, which had nothing to do with anybody testified about. Yeah. But then you realize it's just a dog and pony show. They want to pretend that they have relied upon world experts, and they're just doing what the heck they want to do anyhow. So I wrote a letter to Reagan at the time. I said, you people are absolutely nuts. You're going to increase volatility by doing this. I mean, I posted a letter, and I got a 2-page letter back from the White House, very nice, saying, oh, no, you know, you're the only one basically with a volatility model, you know, until somebody else agrees with you on that, we can't listen to just one. Then 87 comes, and oh my God, the number one problem is volatility.
Yeah, who would have thought?
You know, and then you can look at the Brady Commission report. At the end, my biggest accomplishment was to get them to admit that it had to do with currency. Mm-hmm. And they basically said, we think the crash had something to do with currency. That's it.
Yeah.
You know, they couldn't blame the G5. Gee, the government caused this. But you stand up and you say, we're going to devalue the dollar by 40%. You sold a third of the national debt to Japan. Now you're telling them you're going to devalue it by 40%. Don't you think they would sell?
Yeah.
You know, that's logical. This is our problem. We have politicians that are completely ignorant. They don't know what they're doing. They've never traded markets, and you're lucky if they ever had a real job.
Mm-hmm.
And they stand up and they belt out this kind of nonsense, and it creates tremendous volatility, And it's just crazy. You have people like Larry Summers and saying, oh, well, people won't spend, so let's punish them. Let's take interest rates negative, and then they'll force them to spend.
Yeah.
If they don't want to spend, they're not going to spend. They just take the money out. Then he realizes, so they're defeating what I wanted to do. Oh, we should cancel all currency. instead of saying, maybe you're wrong.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe you
just
might
maybe,
be.
You know?
That's possible.
Let's eliminate all currency so they have to keep it in the bank account. Then we'll charge them negative interest rates if they don't spend it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just, it's one authoritarian move after another.
Mm-hmm. Very true. Well, Martin, I kind of like, we got to go now. So this spiral is going to continue. Market's going to continue higher, and it's going to confound the skeptics and the critics alike, and more of the same, huh?
Yeah. 2018 is just the beginning of this. And we're going from here out to 2020 to 2021. Then you're going to see, basically after this year, things are going to get very, very crazy.
2021 seems to be a pivotal year, though. It's the year after the next presidential election. And it's also, it'll make it the 21st year of the century. Always something happening there. And we had it in 1921. So cyclically, there's a lot riding on 2021.
Yeah, we're definitely looking at a monetary crisis cycle. And that's the first window of opportunity where we'll see a monetary reform like Bretton Woods. But honestly, it might end up that just be the first wave of volatility, and we may have to wait till 2032.
All right. Well, we will see what happens.